Good morning and welcome to worship with West End United Methodist Church. My name's Doug Arnold and I serve on the Hospitality Ministries team. We're so glad that you've joined us this morning. Although Easter Sunday was April the 4th, we continue to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus in this 50-day season called Eastertide. You will find worship materials in the description section of our live feed, including an order of worship and links to our hymns. We also invite you to light a candle as a sign of Christ's presence with you today. We hope you experience the joy of Easter as we worship together.
Greetings, my friends, and happy Easter to all of you. We continue in this season of Easter, and it is a joy to be worshiping with all of you, those who are here in the sanctuary this morning and those who are joining us over live stream. May the Spirit of the risen Christ unite us with one heart and one voice as we worship together this morning. I have just a few announcements to share with us as we gather together. First, for those of you who are worshiping over live stream, we would ask that you would sign in this morning and let us know that you are with us. There should be a link in the chat alongside the video that will give you an opportunity to do that. And we have some wonderful news in terms of reopening. We have a task force that has been guiding us and helping us make good decisions over this past year. And we met last week and made some decisions that we will be expanding the capacity in our sanctuary to 225. So we'll be able to welcome more folks safely. We will take RSVPs for worship for the next couple of weeks because of some of the things happening in worship. But after May 16th, as of May 16th, we'll try not doing the reservation system and just trust and assume that our numbers will work out well. And we'll take that that part of our process out of the running. Our main guidance is that we always need to remain masked and maintain social distance and hand washing, and within those parameters in our building, we can begin to gather in classes and groups, and most especially for worship. And this just gives me an opportunity to thank those who are on our advisory team for all of your wisdom and prayer and guidance over this past year. As we continue to offer live stream worship and other opportunities through live stream, we are in need of more volunteers for our media team. It takes 4 people to do each worship service. And we have some folks who've been doing such hard work over the past year, and they need reinforcements and help. You don't need any experience, and you can contact Chase Benson or Shelley Kohlmeyer. Their email addresses are on our website, and they can hook you up with some ways that you can help with worship on Sundays. Our youth are gathering tonight here at the church at 5 o'clock from 5 to 6:30 for a photo scavenger hunt. And if you have a young person, 7th through 12th grade, in your home, we invite you to bring them along and have this moment together. And finally, our Project Thrive team, this is a group of leaders in the church who are helping us be part of what's called Project Thrive, 20 churches in the inner core of Nashville who are working together, are calling all of us to this moment where we have some conversations around who we are and what's happening in our community. They sent out a survey this week to church members, so we ask that you would fill that out when you have a few minutes. It'll just take 5 minutes. And then to mark your calendar either for Wednesday, May 12th at 6 p.m. or Saturday, May 15th at 8:30 a.m. To join in a conversation that we hope will take an hour, maybe 75 minutes, and that will be both in person and over Zoom. More details about that coming. But we hope you'll mark one of those dates and participate with us. This morning, we're beginning a 3-week journey through the letter of 1 John. A letter that is all about love, that calls us to love as God loves. So let us open our hearts and minds to this lovely little letter and hear its invitation into a life of love.
Lord, hear to gather by Christ. We worship God when we live lives of love. Christ set the example of what love is. As Christ lay aside his life for us, we are called to respond boldly to this command. Through Jesus' death and resurrection, we are freed from our captivity to sin and death. With gratitude for God's marvelous love for all the world, let us confess our sins, confident that we will receive mercy and grace. O loving Christ, we confess that we have struggled for generations with your command to love one another. When we are called to act boldly, we fall back on words instead. Forgive us for the times we have refused to help our siblings. Forgive us for choosing to surround ourselves in materialistic comforts, so we don't have to see the hurting world around us. Forgive us for the times we forget to abide in you. You give us this commandment again today. May we respond boldly, receiving your loving and guiding spirit. May we act when there is a need. May we fight for truth and justice when the system is failing. May we be people of love, generosity, and conviction. May we believe in your mission and ministry so that we might continue doing the work you have started. Friends, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now, as a forgiven and reconciled people, both here in person and online, let us exchange signs of reconciliation and love. The peace of Christ be with you. Please be seated. One of the great joys of the church is the baptism of children. This morning, Durham and Sarah Pettigrew bring their daughter to God before the community of faith for baptism.
My family in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we're initiated into Christ's holy church. We're incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. And all of this is God's gift, offered to us without price. Durham and Sarah, I ask you now on behalf of the whole church these ancient questions of the faith. Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin?
We do.
I believe she's ready to answer for herself, it looks like. The second question is, do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to all people?
And will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life.
We will.
And now, my friends in the congregation, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, please say, we do. And will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include this child now before you in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround this child with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in service with others. We will pray for her to be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. Let us pray. Eternal God, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and this beautiful child who receives it, to wash away sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in Christ's final victory. All praise to you, eternal God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. And what name have you given your child?
Clara
Elizabeth. I baptize you in the name of God, your Creator, Christ, your Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, your Advocate and Comforter. Amen. And now all of us can maybe place a hand on Clara, maybe her foot or her shoulder, and we're all going to pray for the gift of God's Spirit in her life. Let us pray. Clara, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ all the days of your beautiful life. Amen. Now, Clara is wearing a gown that her great-grandmother made for her and for her siblings and cousins, and we're so glad to celebrate this beautiful day with you. And we're going to make our promise to you now as a congregation.
Clara Elizabeth, it is now our joy to welcome our new sister in Christ. Members of the household of God, I commend Clara Elizabeth to your love and your care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, Clara Elizabeth, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you, in the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant to participate faithfully in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Let us pray together the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and the word proclaimed, that we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. A lesson from the New Testament, the first book of John, chapter 3, verses 16 through 24. And we know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this, we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Christ Jesus, and love one another just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit he has given us. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Take a special moment with the children. I know we've got some kids here this morning, and we have some joining us over live stream. I want to show you something that somebody made for me. Now, maybe from where you're sitting, it just looks like a white square, maybe a white washcloth. But if you look really close and if you run your fingers over it, there's an outline of a dog. And you can tell that this was knit by someone. Someone made this. This was made by a friend of mine who knows how much I love dogs. And I was getting ready to move, and she made this for me to take with me. She said, "I want you to remember that I love you." And as I thought about the fact that she made this, and with every stitch, she was thinking about me. And the fact that she put a dog on there, she knows me and she knows how much I love my dog. And so it was really special to me that she showed me her love by making this for me. And I have kept it all of these years. In our scripture reading today, there's a man named John who's written a letter to a church. And he's telling the church that we're supposed to love each other. And he says, we love in truth and action. We put our love into action. So love is not just a feeling. It's what we do to show our love to people. So one question is, how can you show your love to the people in your life? Maybe you could draw a picture for someone. Maybe you could give a hug to someone in your family. Or when you walk by a stranger on the street, you can look them in the eye and smile. And even if you're wearing a mask, they'll know you're smiling by your eyes. There are lots of ways that we can show our love to people, and it's important that we do. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you so much for loving us. You love us just as we are. Help us to love other people as you love us, and help us to show how we love people, to put our love into action by doing kind things and being generous and giving hugs and drawing pictures and sharing food. Help us as a church to be people who continue to show your love to the world in all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I was driving into work this week. Can I just tell you how happy it makes me to say that? I was driving into work. I came to my office. I was wearing work clothes that I haven't worn for a year. It's such a joy to be able to come back to work and see my colleagues and begin to feel like things are getting back to normal. You may have noticed that the traffic in Nashville is getting a little bit back to normal. So I was driving to work, and I found myself in a little bit of traffic, sitting at a stop sign right behind a pickup truck. And on the back of the pickup truck, it wasn't quite a bumper sticker. It was a word that the driver had put together with little squares that you might use on a mailbox, you know. Five letters. T-R-U-T-H. Truth. Now, what would you think if you saw that on the back of someone's car? I'm ashamed to admit, my first reaction was, oh boy. My first assumption was that the driver was someone who had very strong and clear opinions, most likely political opinions, and that this person wanted to announce to the world that he thought he was right, and if you disagreed with him, then you're wrong. My mind just started spinning like that. And I began to realize how this word, truth, has become divisive in our age. It's hard to understand how that has happened, really. But in an age when someone can just start up a website and start putting out these conspiracy theories that millions of people will follow and believe, how do we know what's true? In a world where there can be something that looks like a news article, and you read it, and then you find out later it wasn't, how do we know what's true? As a parent, we've been teaching our children, you gotta check and double check and triple check all of your sources. Just because something's on the internet doesn't mean it's true. Just because something's in a book doesn't mean it's true. Just because a political leader in a dark suit stands up and says something doesn't mean it's true. In fact, just because a preacher or teacher says something doesn't mean it's true. You got to dig in, investigate for yourself, check your sources, find sources that you trust. And it's hard to do in any age, but in our age especially. This morning, we get to overhear a letter that a church leader, he calls himself the elder, we don't know his name, but church history has given him the name John, so we'll call him John. We get to overhear this letter that John has written to faith community. And it's a community that seems to be having some trouble figuring out what's true. They're starting to question things. John, or someone like him, had started these faith communities with the witness about Jesus the Christ, that he was the Son of God, and had taught these folks how Jesus had lived, what he had taught, how he had died and been raised from the dead. And they had been grounded in that truth of Christ. But at some point along the line, there were some other teachers, other authority figures who began to mix in with the congregation and teach some other things that were arousing doubts and chipping away at the foundation of what the congregation thought they knew and understood. And so John writes this letter, and two others later, we think, to remind them of what they already know, to remind them of what is true. And in this letter of John, what is truth is love. What is truth is God's love revealed in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus the Christ. There are other things that we might debate and talk about, but John says, this is true. This is what we know. God is love. And we have been loved by God, and if we have been loved by God, then we must love one another. And in this letter, he repeats it again and again. Love God, love your neighbor. Love God, love your neighbor. Love God, Love your neighbor as yourself. It's the heart of it all. It is the truth upon which our lives are built. I think that's one reason I love this little letter so much. Because for me, that's the heart of everything. In seasons of my life, when I've gone through doubts and questions and struggled with things, I could always return to the truth that God is love, that God loves me, and that I'm called to love neighbors, strangers, and even enemies. The question is, we might ask, what does that mean? What is love? And in this text we've just heard, John makes it very clear that love, let us love not in word and speech, but in truth and action. It's not just about saying we love. It's not about feeling warm and fuzzy toward people. It's about what we do, how we treat other people, the actions that we take to promote the well-being and even the flourishing of another or of others. And John says, this is how we know what love looks like. We look to Christ. Christ, who was God in the flesh, who laid down his life. He laid down his rights and his privileges and his power. He laid down his innocence and took the path of love that took him all the way to the cross so that all of us could know that we're never alone in our suffering, that God will go all the way to be with us and for us. And so, John says, if God is willing to lay down God's very life for us, how then do we do that in our lives? How do we love others? It's not an easy question to answer. We wake up every morning with every interaction and have to consider, how do I love in this situation? What does love look like in this moment, in this interaction? I have a dear friend who gave me this question to use as a tool in discernment. What does love ask of me in this moment? Maybe that will be helpful to you if you're trying to figure out how best to act in love towards someone or in a situation. What does love ask of me? And we look to the example of Jesus to see what love looks like in the flesh. We see Jesus healing. We see Jesus welcoming the stranger, including the outcasts, speaking with authority and confrontation to the religious authorities, holding people accountable. Love looks different depending on the interaction. So sometimes love looks like a warm casserole the day after a funeral. Sometimes love looks like rocking babies in the NICU at Vanderbilt Hospital. Sometimes love looks like giving a cold glass of water to someone who's thirsty. Sometimes love looks like saying no when someone's asking for what they want in order to bring about their flourishing and their well-being, if we know that giving them what they want is not what they need. Love takes on a lot of faces and a lot of different kinds of actions. But we don't always know. It's not always easy to discern what the loving action is. And that's why we need each other. That's what the community of faith is all about. This is a learning laboratory for love. This is the place, or these are the people among whom we learn about love. We gather together and we study the life of Jesus and we invite the Holy Spirit to shape us and teach us. And we talk together about the situations in our lives, and we help each other see what the loving action might be. We join together in voices so that we might be a louder voice for love in our community, to help make the policies and the systems in our community more loving. And we trip and we fall and we fail and we forgive each other and we lift each other back up and we get back out there to share God's love with the world. And I'm so grateful for the companionship of all of you on this journey, because I've got a long way to go in learning how to love. Which brings me back to that stop sign a few days ago. There I was judging the driver of that pickup truck when I looked above where the word truth was on his bumper, and it said in the same little gold letters, "Peace, be still." And it was as if God was saying to me, "Shush your judgments. Take a moment to recognize that the truth of God's love for us, for me, and for all people is that we're all one. We are all in this together. And God's love binds us together, whether we agree on everything or not." And then as the truck pulled out onto the street, I saw on the side of his truck the word love. And he had blessed me. My judgmental, reluctant self had been blessed by the love of a stranger. May we go from this time of worship to bless the stranger, to bless one another, even to bless our enemies with the love of God that has been so generously poured out upon us. Thanks be to God.
Part of the ways that we learn to love is by proclaiming the creeds that help remind us of who we are, what we believe, and what we're called to. So if you will stand with us in body or spirit and turn to page 883 in your hymnal to proclaim the United Church of Canada's statement of faith. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, and life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated. As we come to our time of prayer, I invite you to lift up both your silent and spoken prayers. If you'd like to share them with the pastoral team who will be praying for you this week, we ask that you would follow the link under Contact Us on the website. And if you're here in person, I hope that you'll write down your prayer request and put it in the offering box in the narthex as you leave. I'd like to share with you the joys and concerns of the community. This morning, we celebrate the birth of Anne Frances Coleman. Was born April the 2nd in Washington, D.C. to Rob and Katie Bowers Coleman. She is welcomed also by her big brother, Charlie Coleman, grandparents Nan and Greg Bowers, and Aunt Amy Bowers Myers. And our deepest sympathies are extended to four families this morning. Laurel and Massey Hemingway and their family are mourning the death of her mother, Earlene Strickland, who passed away on April the 18th in Lyman, South Carolina. West End music intern Scott Bronz and his family are mourning the death of his grandparents, David Viehe Blackburn, who passed away on April 9th, and Kay McCullough Blackburn, who passed away on April the 16th. We also mourn with Tom Lease and family after the death of his wife, Liz Lease, who passed away on Monday the 19th. And Jeff Ackerman and his family are mourning the death of his father, Foster Ackerman of Lexington, Kentucky, who passed away on April the 21st at the age of 100 years and 215 days. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Wise and loving God, we give you thanks for all the gifts you give to us, for daily food, for health, for each breath we take, for the gifts of community and faith. Our hearts are truly overwhelmed, O God, when we consider that it is your nature to give yourself to us. As the scripture reads, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for others. Yet our souls are weary, O God. It's hard to think about giving our lives for others when we see how great the need is and we witness the terror and trauma all around us. And so we turn to you in intercession. We bring before you the concerns which have weighed on our hearts. For the members of our families, church, and communities who need your healing, both physically and mentally. For the strength and tenacity of movements of equality and justice. For the world as we continue to navigate the confusion, risk, and challenges of a global pandemic. Bless and encourage all who feel like giving up. Be with and guide those who care for the sick. And draw near to those who are grieving. And yet our prayers must move us to reach out in love and connection to others. Thank you for the reminder in this scripture and worship that like Jesus, we must not only love with our words and prayers, but with our actions and in truth. Lead us, guide us, move us, and motivate us to act as you have done, unconditionally and sacrificially in spirit and truth. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we come to the part of our service where we give our tithes and offerings, we recognize that the pandemic has affected everyone differently. If you're unable to give at this time, we understand. But if you're in a position to give or to give more than usual, we encourage you to do so. This will help us continue our mission around the world to serve our community and those around the world. For those of you who are worshiping online, you can see the options to give on the screen. For those of you in person, there are offering boxes in the narthex in the back of the sanctuary where you can leave your offering following the service. As we give our tithes and offerings this morning, let us offer our hearts to a loving God.
is our story. We hear it and receive it in this place, in worship together. And we go out and tell the story of love in truth and action to a world that needs to hear the good news. Go empowered by Christ's love to shine Christ's light of love. Amen.